In My Mind är skriven och producerad av Robin Söderman och David Westerlund.
We were glad we put so much time into just arranging the radio edit, because that's the most important. If you want to have sell a lot of records, you have to be successful on the radio.
We started to work with it and felt like if this is not working out, if this song is not going to make it, this is the final thing we're doing.
Antiloop består av Robin Söderman och David Westerlund. De är båda två uppväxta på Lidingö utanför Stockholm, där de umgicks redan som små. Robin är Antiloops teknikexpert och producent. David är en klassisk skolad pianist och har även spelat piano i ett storband.
It's a very interesting combination because David is a musician and starts to play piano when he was 12 or something like that. Robin, on the other hand, he was an extremely good computer man, so the first hacker I've ever met. So here was a great combination of a very, very talented musician and a very talented engineer.
Robin och David började tidigt att intressera sig för musik. Den första gruppen de hade tillsammans hette Gostrum. Musiken de gjorde då var filmisk och melodiös. De började också tidigt att DJa på klubbar och fritidsgårdar.
So we were both into DJing and the music at the time. And then after a while we thought maybe we should try making our own music. I was very tired at DJing at the time as well.
...1994 fick Robin ett erbjudande att vara med och starta ett studiokollektiv på Lidingö. Kollektivet döptes till Vår lilla studio.
First he called me up and then he said, I'm gonna start a studio, are you interested in maybe trying to make your own music? And I said, what the hell, yeah, of course. And we needed more people for this studio. So this guy asked me, do you have other friends that make music? And I knew David was DJing at the time as well. So we called him up and then he came down and me and David started working together and that's like how it started.
I was kind of surprised because when I entered the studio it was empty. It was just an empty room, so I was like, okay.
Efter ett tag anslöt sig fler personer och snart hade man en fungerande studio. Robin och David arbetade inte i en fast grupp, men det föll sig snart naturligt att det var de som skulle jobba ihop.
All the other guys in the studio, except for me and Robin, they were like pretty. They didn't have like any big visions, or I don't think they actually knew what they wanted to do. And they started to work with some new projects like once every week, you know. So they never completed anything. So I think that's why we teamed up in this studio.
Both me and David were playing instrumental dance music, or that's the music that felt best for us playing, because it was dance music, not a lot of vocals, just hard grooves, and that's what we liked at the time. And that for us came quite naturally, started making this kind of music, because we were playing it as well.
The first song we made in the studio ever was like some really strange ambient kind of song. It was like 10 minutes long and nothing actually happened in the song. It was like very, very boring.
Men snart fann de det sound som skulle komma att göra dem berömda. Tillsammans med de övriga i studion beslöt man sig för att spela in en demo.
So what we did was all the people in the studio made a couple of songs each and we put it all into a DAT tape. And the funny thing was that we all helped each other finishing our songs. So this was like a demo from all the group. It was like 6 people, I think. Different constellations with different people in different groups and different songs. So I think we had a DAT tape with 6 different songs that we mailed to a record company called Fluid Records.
Fluid Records är ett underbolag till Stockholm Records och det startades av Glenn Carlson och Magnus Nordin. Initiativet till bildandet av Fluid Records var Ola Håkanssons. Han ville på detta sätt fånga upp de nya talangerna inom teknomusiken. Den första som lyssnade på den demokassett som kollektivet från vår lilla studio skickade var Magnus Nordin. Magnus har själv ett förflutet som musiker i teknobandet MDA.
I immediately spotted the Antelope tracks because they were standing out from the rest.
I heard from another guy that I knew that was working on this record company that they were interested in our demo, so we called them up to see which song they wanted or if they wanted all of them. We actually thought that at the moment that they wanted maybe one or two or maybe three songs. And then when we got in touch with them, they said we want one song, and that is the song that's called Beauty and the Beast. And we checked the DAT, Beauty and the Beast was our song, number three.
Demon ledde till ett skivkontrakt och Fluid Records ville ha med Antelopes låt Beauty and the Beast på bolagets första samlingsskiva, Jungle to Trance.
Quite early, we could see that they were probably the most interesting of the new bands in that kind of scene.
Av de svenska akterna som medverkade på Jungle to Trance blev Antelope den mest uppmärksammade.
National radio here in Sweden started playing one song particularly from the CD, and that was our song.
En av de första som upptäckte Antelope var Kalle Dernulf, programledare för radioprogrammet P3 Dans.
The reactions I got was that people liked it and thought it sounded different and it had those elements, commercial side to it and a little bit energetic underground Russian feel to it.
That was the first song when I think we found something special in our work. So that's actually the song that has shaped our music.
At that time, the scene was not there. I mean, it was a very, very small scene in Sweden. But the Beauty and the Beast was a sort of a grower. So even if we started in the clubs, people started to vote for it, and they write to the radio to ask them to play it, and we received a lot of inquiries about the song. So we understood this is much bigger than just a little electro dance thing.
So almost overnight, me and David had to represent this group called Antelope, and you know, from being just a hobby band, two friends making music together, that was quite a big step.
Efter framgångarna med samlingsskivan beslöt man på skivbolaget att Antelope skulle släppa en egen singel.
We didn't think that it was very fun to just release a single with one track, because what we really wanted to do was make an album. But since this was supposed to be like in a single format or EP format, we thought of making an EP instead with four tracks.
We had to make an EP quite fast because the record company realized that Antelope maybe could break them quite early.
Man gick in i studion och började arbeta. Men samarbetet i vår lilla studio fungerade inte lika bra som förut.
Since we were like a lot of people working in the same studio, it was hard to find time in the studio because it was always booked.
Neither me or David could work as much as we wanted. We were like the most successful group in this studio complex, but we could not get time to work.
Efter förseningar släpper slutligen Antelope sin första egna skiva, en EP med fyra låtar.
Me and David put together four tracks together with Beauty and the Beast, and we put it on the EP called NSFMC. That was named not suitable for mass consumption, because we thought this will not work commercially, and we thought it was a good name. We saw it in a movie, I think.
Men de hade fel. Not suitable for mass consumption sålde mer än väntat. Skivan innehåller egentligen inga nya låtar utan bara remixer på Beauty and the Beast, och skivbolaget ville nu att man skulle ge ut en skiva till med nytt material. Antelope fick nu för första gången känna på att arbeta under press.
We decided to go along and make an album with them as soon as possible.
They wanted us to release an EP very fast, because they thought that maybe we were the act on their label that could, you know, make it commercial wise.
I always try to tell them, give me something you like and let your stomach talk. Don't try to be clever, don't try to make things because people expect it or journalists expect you to do another record. So I still think that the pressure was more that from themselves and for the people around them.
Förväntningarna på Antiloops nästa skiva var stora. Radio och tidningar hade uppmärksammat dem och samtidigt växte problemen i vår lilla studio.
The guy that ran the studio, he wanted us to pay like half of everything, of the record sales, and if we were doing a remix, he wanted half.
After a while, we thought, hey, this is not working, we need our own studio. So we moved, or asked our record company, could we get a studio from you guys?
Because of the situation for Antiloop, they were together with some friends at Lidingö, where they didn't own the studio, they were just a part of three or four different producers or bands or whatever it was. I definitely thought that they were a very talented band and we wanted to continue with them, so we find them a room.
I den nya studion fick Antiloop arbetsro. Gruppen släppte sin andra EP, Purpose in Life. Samtidigt hade deras framgångar gjort att de också fick många förfrågningar om att göra remixer för andra artister. Photogenic, Army of Lovers och Aqua är bara några av alla de band man arbetade med.
Other people had also, of course, discovered the talent of the band, and for them it's very, there's a big temptation for the other bands to ask Antiloop to do remixes, and for Antiloop to do remixes to make a lot of money out of the remixes, and they don't have to go through all the problems with writing your own stuff. It's an easy way to get some money in the beginning. So many times young producers are tempted to do that.
We made a lot of remixes, and our remixes was commercially very successful. They were even played more on the radio than our own tracks.
It wasn't really as fun to do remixes as making our own music, but it was pretty income bringing. We earned some money making remixes, and we needed money to buy new equipment all the time.
We were almost at the point where we felt, okay, are we going to go this way or this way? One way is doing the remixes, because we knew we could live on that, and a lot of other people did at the time. Or should we try to make Antiloop just more successful with our own music?
Antiloops egna förväntningar på Purpose in Life var höga. Men skivan sålde inte lika bra som man hade hoppats på. Robin och David funderade allvarligt på att sluta helt med att producera egen musik.
I still believe in the band. I mean, for me, you see the talent, and the talent was still there. Sometimes it takes some time before you find it.
Duon fortsatte att jobba med sin egen musik. David tillbringade all sin lediga tid i studion. Robin, som fortfarande hade ett jobb att sköta, kom in på kvällar och helger.
So I came to the studio at night around 6 or something, and he said, listen to this, and he played up this theme for me, and I was like astonished right away, wow, this sounds really good. And he said, we should work on this, this could really be a nice track. And that was the beginning for a song called In My Mind.
We started to work with it and felt like, if this is not working out, if this song is not going to make it, this is the final thing we're doing.
We started to making the track by adding drums, bass, and a lot of people came into the studio all the time and heard this track, because it was so direct right away. You heard, this must be a single, or this must be a hit.
I knew that this was a sound that we could build a group around. It was very special, it was very new. At the same time, the melody was commercial enough to make a crossover over it.
Magnus blev mycket imponerad av den nya låten. Han bestämde sig för att man ska börja göra remixer av den, trots att Antiloop själva inte var klara med sin egen version.
I mean, we did not have an intro, we were not finished with the arrangement, and we were not finished with the mix. So for us, hearing all these other people working in the other studios on the same track and finishing their remixes, we were not even done. That felt really strange. So, but instead of, you know, stressing everything around, we took our time because we felt this is really a good track and we should put a lot of effort into it, and we did, and I'm glad for that today.
En av dem som remixade In My Mind var kända producenten Stonebridge, som bland annat jobbat med Robin och Mel C.
I mean, they were very popular, getting very popular in Sweden, and since I knew them, they asked me, you know, and I felt a bit honored. And it was a bit of a problem for me, but the remix turned out quite interesting. You know, I kept the vibe of their music, but with my beats and bass, more or less.
Remixerna av In My Mind blev klara en efter en, men Antilop själva hade kört fast. Det största problemet var att skriva ett bra intro till låten.
Finally, we started the song with some strings. I was thinking maybe we should do something with strings, sounding like a classical tune instead, because it could make like a nice contrast when the bass drum goes on. So we tried that out, and it felt really good.
Introdelen av In My Mind består av tre olika stråkar som man kombinerade.
Because we wanted it to sound real, like it would have been like an orchestra playing it. And I think we managed to do that because some people came up to us afterwards and said that, asked where we sampled the intro from. And we were like, we did it ourselves.
Temasekvensen i In My Mind börjar i dur, men går sedan över i moll. Inom den klassiska musiken är detta ett vanligt grepp. Men inom teknomusiken var det vid den här tidpunkten inte lika vanligt förekommande.
Since we had a kick-ass tune coming, we knew we wanted to make a really cool production out of it. So one thing we did was to sample one of the first tones from the theme and add a really, really big reverb to it. And then we recorded this reverb and reversed it to get this a kind of reverse effect before the beat starts. That gave the song an extra push.
It sounds really simple, but when you listen to it really, it's quite complex.
The equipment we used at the time were really basic, or are really basic, because all we had was actually a sampler, an analog mixing desk, a Behringer MX-8000, I think. Yeah, and our synthesizers. So compared to what we're working on today, totally digital and everything on computer, this was really Stone Age equipment. But that only proves it doesn't matter what kind of equipment you have. I mean, the most important is still the idea of the song, or in this case, the theme.
Antiloop arbetar med hårddiskbaserad inspelning. Detta sätt att jobba på slog igenom i Sverige för cirka 5 år sedan. Innan dess arbetar man med MIDI.
Using hard disk, all the sound on the hard disk is for us a really a great advantage. Not only because using MIDI is quite slow and not reliable, but also we have total recall of everything we do. We can actually pick up a song we made 2 months ago and get it to sound exactly the way it did when we worked on it the last time.
Den musik som Antilop gör hade inte varit möjlig att göra via MIDI. Genom att först spela in alla ljuden på hårddisk får man större kontroll över låten. Med MIDI kan man också råka ut för att det blir otajt om man använder flera ljud från många olika ljudkällor samtidigt. Nackdelen med att jobba uteslutande med datorer kan vara att man skapar en ljudbild som är för perfekt.
Working digitally like we do today, sometimes we need to like dirten up the sounds, and what we do right then is use plugins in this digital environment for making the sounds sound more dirty or more broken. And also working in this environment, you get a pretty clean sound. There's no noise, no hum, no nothing when we come with the music to the mastering. So that's why we also choose an analog mastering here in Stockholm, to get a bit more warmth into the productions and the songs, since it's all made here digital in the studio.
Antiloop har ett karaktäristiskt ljud som ligger långt ifrån de monotona 20 minuters låtar man tidigare förknippade teknomusiken med. Men det mest karaktäristiska för Antiloop är förmodligen att det ofta i deras låtar förekommer en samplad röst.
Making this kind of music, since it's instrumental, it's quite important that you use some type of vocal sample. So what we did, one of the last things we did actually, was to add this voice, the guy that says in my mind repeatedly, and that became more or less like a gimmick for the song because people remembered it really easy.
Samplingen de använde kommer från en gammal house-skiva. När låten var klar återstod mixningen. Man gjorde ett flertal slutmixar som alla skiljer sig minimalt från varandra.
I think we made 7 or 8 mixes of the track because we had a hard time to decide which one was the best. Maybe the bass drum is too loud and maybe the theme is not coming out really. Maybe it should be louder and stuff like that. You have to decide. Now it's done, because otherwise you can work with like a song forever.
Ett annat sätt man känner igen Antiloop på är på det sätt de bygger upp sina låtar. In My Mind har samma struktur som en klassisk poplåt. En introdel, ett tema motsvarande versen samt en refrängdel. Singelversionen av In My Mind har dessutom ungefär samma längd som de flesta poplåtar, cirka 3 minuter.
I loved it. I thought it was great.
Att In My Mind skulle släppas som singel var det inget tvivel om. Och som alltid när man ska lansera en ny låt så gjorde man även en video.
That's very important with the electro music or with artists sort of like David and Robin. They're not faces. They're more DJs or producers. And because of that you need a video because you don't put them on television programs. They're not at Bingo Lotto or these big TV shows. So you really need a good video for them, for that kind of music.
Antiloop blev kända genom sina tidiga skivor, men med låten In My Mind kom deras stora genombrott. Och med den låten lyckades de även nå ut till den breda publik som vanligtvis inte lyssnade på techno.
Antiloop is the biggest club act that has happened to Sweden because they've made dance music known and popular to an audience that never really cared about dance music.
Skivbolaget beslutar sig för att lansera gruppen utomlands. Det innebär att man måste anpassa marknadsföringsstrategierna efter de omständigheter som råder i varje land. I Frankrike är till exempel radion det viktigaste instrumentet när det gäller dansmusik.
The most important thing for this kind of music is radio, not clubs, because here we use the clubs for to break the record, but in France you use the radio for this kind of music, which is completely different.
We were glad we put so much time into just arranging the radio edit, because that's the most important. If you want to sell a lot of records, you have to be successful on the radio.
When Energy in Sweden played it a lot, because Energy is a French radio station. I was down at Medem, so we talked to the French people, to the publishers, and to at that time Polygram, Polydor in France, and they released it, and they were very happy about it. They thought that we could have a hit, but they really didn't know how to start the thing. So I made a phone call to Energy in Stockholm and asked them for a favor. Please tell your pals in France how big this thing is in Sweden. So Energy really helped us out here because they made a phone call to Paris and said, yes, this is a great thing in Sweden. So they start playing it.
Singen In My Mind sålde snart guld. Och under 98 års Grammisgala belönades Antiloop med en Grammis i kategorin Best Modern Dance 97. Under Swedish Dance Music Awards samma år så tog de hem inte mindre än 4 utav de 9 priser som utdelades. Bland annat för bästa album och bästa artist. Och Antiloops framgångar var inte bara begränsade till Sverige. Låten In My Mind klättrade högt upp på de europeiska topplistorna.
I think we sold over 200,000 copies in France. And the French people loved that song, really. You could go anywhere in the streets. If you went to McDonald's, you would hear In My Mind on the radio. If you went by a cab, you would hear it in the cab. It was playing all the time.
When I look back and think about what happened to Antilope, it's a little bit amazing to realize how fast they hit success.
Looking back now, I realize that they were quite ahead of their time.
Obviously, it's good production, and it's good sounds and good melodies.
It was a perfect hook.
Nobody had heard anything like it before. It was like techno or dance, but still it was like arranged, like a pop song.
A good refrain, really.
The beat was very suitable for radio.
You need like a vocal hook into it.
In a few years' time, everyone will see what they've meant.